Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Thank you so much, Kathrin, for joining us tonight.
Thank you.
Do you live in Zurich?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so you didn't have to travel too far. Our last guest had to travel from Munich here. He drove here, and then as soon as it was over the interview part, he jumped in his car and drove back to Munich. So.
Okay.
But I guess you don't have support to go tonight.
No, I don't have support.
Awesome. So, we like to start off by finding out a little bit about you personally. Where did you grow up from? Are you originally from Zurich?
Yes, I'm from Zurich. I grew up here. I went here to school and to university. I still live here. I was traveling a lot of the year, but now I'm here.
So you're from a big city, at least as far as Switzerland goes.
No.
Yeah. And as a kid, did you already have startup ambitions? Did you feel entrepreneurial? Did you have any influence? Were your parents related somehow to having their own companies?
Actually, I wasn't. I did have entrepreneurs in my family. Actually, pretty, like, there are some, but I was never related with entrepreneurship at all. It came later when I after my Friday, I went abroad and I built clothes which I exported to Switzerland, and it was only for 4 weeks, but I could cover my whole year expenses. So I saw at that time that it was very easy just to build something. When you have something, you can sell.
Right.
So, but afterwards I went to university, I went to a corporate. I was working in product management. I didn't feel like building something myself. It was more the idea which brought me to the entrepreneurship.
Okay. So as a kid, you weren't selling candies to your classmates or?
I did, but I mean everybody did sell something. So like paintings and yeah, whatever.
Right. Okay. And so you said you were working in corporate environment, and what triggered the interest in starting your own company? What was the turning point?
I'm interested in the healthcare sector since a long time. I when I was at university, I studied politics, mm-hmm. and we had some major topics about healthcare systems. I was very fascinated about the topic and how you could serve people and how you could do healthcare systems more efficient. So since studying, I was into this topic. It was private ambition. And after 2 years, so 3 years after graduating, I had with a friend the case, and she was looking for a nutritionist, and I saw the first time as a user how difficult it was to find a therapist or a nutritionist or somebody who's not a typical doctor.
Right.
So, and if you don't want to go to your doctor, if you don't want to talk with people about problems, it's pretty difficult to find yourself in this market. So it was more actually a social project in the beginning, an idea which I wanted to build in any case.
Right.
And it was later on where we saw there is an actual need and there's a product we can sell.
When was this? What year?
In 2015.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. This is where we actually found the company.
Mm-hmm. But you already had the idea sometime before?
Like a year before.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And so why Coachfrog?
Why the name Coachfrog?
Do you like to jump?
Yeah. The idea was we didn't want to have a hospital, mm-hmm. so we didn't want. I mean, most people who come to our platform today, they have problems. Sometimes they have problems for years, and we don't want to get them in an environment where they feel in a hospital,
right.
or you know, you need to get sick when you are in a hospital. I mean, but we wanted to have a surrounding where you feel well and where. So the idea of the Coachfrog was responsibility, to kind of improve responsibility of people according to their health. So this was the reason why we had this jumping frog.
Mm-hmm.
And the coach was just a symbol for the platform for the marketplace,
right,
where we help people get into the right direction.
So what's the tagline? What's the elevator pitch for Coachfrog? How would you explain it to everyone here in the elevator pitch style?
We are a platform where we bring together practitioners, like therapists, and people who are looking for therapy, and we're helping to get the right practitioner for their need. And actually, it's a usual marketplace, but we have a chat and we have active support team. We are now launching a booking system, so this is the last step of the whole system.
Okay. And how did your family and your friends react when you told them that you were going to leave your corporate job to start your own company?
I think they were used to that I have sometimes an idea which I will just do, so I think they were both fine.
Okay. Because it's especially here in Switzerland where everyone is used to the stability and the structure, and when someone starts to do something that's not so structured, there's often some raised eyebrows, but it's nice that it wasn't too big of a challenge from the family side.
No, it wasn't.
Yeah, cool. And how did you know that there was a business opportunity, that you were onto a monetizable opportunity, a plan that could be a business and not just a social opportunity like you originally thought of?
Mm. In the very beginning, we did events with the practitioners, and we found out that they had a problem too, because people, they will not pay you for helping them to get the right practitioner.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe in the future, if you have additional services, they're going to pay the book. We knew it must be the practitioners who's going to pay. And they do have a problem, since they're in the private market. They're not health insurance accepted by the general health insurance company. So they have to see that they have a full-time job, but they have clients.
Right.
So we can sell them marketing, and so they will pay for new clients mostly. And also they said that they have a big administrative problem, so they're still working with papers. And so we can digitalize them, we can help them get new clients, we can reduce their administrative work, and they're willing to pay for that.
Okay. And when you have a platform that caters to consumers and service providers, there's often the challenge of the service providers want to see the clients, and the clients want to see the service providers. So how did you tackle that? With the challenge of selling the concept, if you have a platform with no clients,
okay, two sided market.
Yeah, I mean it's like the chicken and egg. The clients want to see all the practitioners.
Mm.
The practitioners want to see all the clients.
Mm.
And you've got to start somewhere.
Mm.
Who's first?
Yeah. Okay. It was first that we brought like around 600 people on the platform for free. So we had a certain stock of practitioners on the website,
okay. And
they didn't pay at all.
Mm.
So we could start giving them clients. And then we started improving marketing, and at a certain point we started to sell for profiles on the platform. And we do still have some free profiles on the platform in mainly in other cities. And in Zurich we are mainly selling profiles, so it's kind of a first, you need to show these people what you can offer them, and afterwards they will pay for what you offer them if it's worth it.
Right.
So we first have to prove them that it's worth it.
But you first approached the providers, practitioners,
mm-hmm.
got them on the platform, and then you did the marketing to attract the clients.
Mm.
Okay. And how did you start off? Did you bootstrap? Did you take some investment? What was the first year like?
Mm. The very beginning was a bit tricky because we had to pay our own money first of all, and it was expensive and we didn't have a lot of money. And then we could get some more money from around us. And then we had to do a first investment round very early.
Mm-hmm.
But we were lucky because we found people who were already in the business or had done like a similar project before, okay. So we're already in the entrepreneurial area. They could help a lot to build the project, and they could also get us connections into the healthcare system. So yeah, it was mainly the first investment round who gave us the push to build the project.
Okay, and that was already very early on with the concept, more in the concept stage before you had.
No, we did already have a prototype.
Okay.
Mm.
And are you technical?
We actually paid for the prototype like 2,000 Swiss francs. Okay. So it was enough to build a platform which could have like 600 profiles and
okay.
We could do ratings and where we could provide a check that, you know. Like
so you have the basic features.
All the basic features were in there.
Yeah. And from your side, do you have a technical background or do you have a co-founder who's more technically minded?
Yeah, we have CTO. He's the whole
And how did you meet your co-founder?
He saw me on a co-founder's website.
Mm-hmm.
And this
co-founder.
Yeah, I actually don't remember which one it was, but yeah, one of these.
Right.
Yeah.
Cool. And so he helped you with developing the website and became mm-hmm. your CTO,
yeah.
Your co-founder.
Right.
Nice. It's good to know. During the course of the conversation, if anyone has a question, just raise your hand and feel free to let us know and we'll try to get your question as well. We might need to run over with the mic so we can get it on camera, but just let me know if you have a question. So today you have how many people on your platform?
Like 1,600 full profiles and some thousand addresses.
And did you have to do a lot of marketing, or did it have more of an organic growth? How did you tackle the growth element? Did you have to invest a lot from that perspective?
Yeah, so I still ask myself, what is a lot? I mean, what is a lot of marketing? But we have not spent our full marketing investments according to the business plan last year.
Mm-hmm.
Because I saw that I first wanted to sell more before we started to invest more, and I also saw that it's a little bit a political question. So we could do we're in a market which is organized in associations. So these are multiplicators for our market, and we saw that if we can convince the associations to cooperate with us, we have much more strength to convince practitioners to get on the platform. And the same, like if you have to spend it in marketing, like in AdWords or in advertising, it would be much more expensive. So I think it's always like you have to figure out like how much is it worth to bring the practitioners on the platform and how much is it worth to bring a client on the platform. And in our perspective, it's more worth it if a practitioner is paying, it's more mm-hmm. worth to invest into marketing.
Right.
And if you see that you have like multiplicators like associations, or you have multiplicators like media houses, we now work with different magazines and where we see we can bring lots of people on the platform, practitioners and clients for free. So we try to like more invest into people instead of like just marketing. But we do scale up. Nah, for sure.
Okay. And how many employees do you have right now?
15.
15. And you actually launched the company about a year and a half ago?
Like nearly 2 years.
Nearly 2 years.
Yeah, on the 3rd March 2015.
Okay. So almost your second anniversary.
Yeah.
Yeah, cool. And when building the platform, I guess from a technical perspective, often, you know, you're thinking about features and ways to improve the experience. How did you tackle the feature development? Did you figure out, you know, through, you know, launching some features that that's not what they wanted, and spend time and money and on the wrong features? Or how is the technical development or the product development perspective?
I think so. One of the biggest differences between me and the CTO is that he wants to produce and I want to spend money into marketing.
Right.
And so what we do try is that if there are systems which already exist, we don't have to build them ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, for the chat, we have not taken the typical chat system, but we do have taken a system which already exists, so which gives us the possibility to connect the chat in the future with a lot of different practitioners, kind of to build an Uber system out of it. So just to think in the future and to use systems which already have like certain tools integrated, which we might use in the future. For example, we do have Elasticsearch and the search engine as an additional tool for it. We don't have to build our own search system,
right,
apart from the idea with the endorsements and everything we already have. But and then, for example, now we have a booking system. So here was the huge difference. Do we want to build a booking system ourselves, or do we want to use something which already existed? And this was maybe one of the most difficult decisions, because we know it will be our work. I mean, maybe most money we're going to get in the future will be out of the bookings.
Right.
And so do you want to have another system for the bookings, or do you need to build your own? And so the way we went now is that we took an external system, but the system we want to integrate in the future and we want to buy in the future. So to summarize, yes, we do try to take systems which already exist, do the testings before we build something expensive. So as I said before, we paid 2,000 Swiss francs to build a prototype, and just afterwards we built a website which was maybe then 150,
mm-hmm.
but just to test it was enough to have something.
Okay. Yeah. I guess that's often a question that comes up. I mean, how many people have an IT-related project? So it's often a question that comes up is do you build your own or start with like you said, integrating external systems, and then as you grow, because I imagine if you start to expand to other countries and your platform gets a million people on it, you might need to develop your own internal software in order to handle that.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely, I think in from more of a bootstrapping perspective and an MVP or an early stage, there's, like you said, so much that can be done with systems that are already integrated. But I imagine you did a lot of research and a lot of testing in order to discover which one will work for the longest period of time.
Yeah, like many booking systems we looked at, so either they were not good enough, like they were kind of a black box,
right,
or they would never sell. But the system we found was a system which is actually the same we planned.
Okay.
And the two systems, they match pretty well with each other. And since there is an administration tool for the practitioners, which is something totally different than the platform itself, it worked very well to get just the connections in between and have these two tools.
Mm-hmm.
It will stay for a long time. Okay. So we are sure if we build it ourselves, we would maybe do the same. But it's right. I mean, this would be the difficult question. So if you don't have the luck to get a tool which is exactly what it would build, should you take it or not?
Right.
Very difficult question. I think you cannot answer it overall.
Mm-hmm. And case by case basis.
Mm-hmm.
And in I guess you have a basic concept or a plan of what you envision Coachfrog to be from the beginning till now and in the future. How has it been? Any surprises along the way? Has there been any major pivots so far? In you know, originally you thought it would be this, and today it's actually changed into something a little bit different, or very different. Or do you still, are you still following the original concept that you had?
I think we are pretty near with the original concept. But for sure, we, like, at the very beginning, the maybe the idea was pretty basic. So we thought, we're going to do a TripAdvisor for health. So that's it. Mm-hmm. And then we started understanding the problem more and more deeply. So we went into the market, we saw like the needs of the practitioners, we did see the problems of the clients, we did see the political question behind all of the things. So the theme here becomes more complex. And we have built the platform strongly according to the needs of all the shareholders, which are like part of our system or community.
Right.
And so what I think what is different than in the beginning, like for example the feedback system. So in the beginning we had the idea of having the ratings as on TripAdvisor, very basic. And then there was a question about like, okay, Kathrin, you know you don't gonna rate hotels, you're gonna rate people. And often they have a very intimate relationship with each other. And so we talked with the practitioners and so if they would let themselves be rated. And so they started and the experience we did, we now have over 7 ratings and it worked pretty well. And people tell their stories. And it's not about just giving stars and say if it was nice or not.
Right.
It's about the story. It's about people who would, how were their 5 years? How were their, why they had their problems? What they did to become well? What they why did, what the practitioners did to help? And you know, like just the whole success story.
Mm-hmm.
And this is actually also what the people do on the platform.
Mm-hmm.
And what we didn't know in the beginning is that we're going to do the endorsements. So the very specific thing on our platform is actually that people can endorse mm-hmm. methods and they can endorse treatment fields.
Okay, that so, worked for them personally.
Yeah, so they're going to tell practitioner X could help me for my migraine with acupuncture, for example, which helps us in the database to bring people first who could help for the specific treatment field or the specific method
mm-hmm.
better than others.
Okay.
So this was, for example, a little detail we haven't thought about before. Also, today practitioners can hide up to 3 customer feedbacks. You will see as a client that there are hidden feedbacks.
Mm-hmm.
But we do that because if you're going to tell practitioners, you know, you can be rated, there can come anything, you just, you know, just public, and they would say, you know, if something happens, if something... So we did it, and until now we don't have any hidden feedbacks. But it helps a lot to the practitioners,
for
just
sure.
to feel
peace
safe.
Peace of mind.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. And so why do you think no one else has done this yet?
Actually, I asked myself the question too, so it's not nobody anymore, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
So in Austria and Germany, they did something.
So you have competition.
Similar. Yeah, I have the same name, even mostly. and in London, there's one project, and they also expanded into the therapy market.
Mm-hmm.
But we do have a lot of different projects in Europe who do the doctor's market, which is a bit different, but also interesting. I see much more interest in, or like, yeah, fascination into the therapy market because it has more to do with chronic problems, which are more popping up, and it has more to do with self-responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
It has to do with a healthy lifestyle. And I very much believe in this market, which is privately organized, which is privately structured, and but yeah, there are not too many yet in the market. I think on the first view you should go in the medical market, but if you go deeper, I think the therapy market is more interesting because it's privately organized, because it's less competition. what people say sometimes is that the doctor's market has more money, so doctors earn more, so they have more money to spend,
right,
which is true. On the other side, doctors are not in need of new patients often because their basic insurance accepted. So, and on the private healthcare market, which is the therapy market, you have the need of new clients, so they're gonna pay for that.
Okay.
So why there's none, there is, but why there's not so many? Maybe because the market is very complex, and maybe because doctors' market is still on the first place.
And do you see expanding to other countries in the near future, or not so near? You're focusing on Switzerland still?
Yeah, I think you always have your dreams and the reality, and in my dreams we are already expanded a long time. But for sure, we now need to strengthen our positioning in Switzerland and before we can expand.
Okay. And of course, when strengthening your position, that means hiring new people. So far, you've hired about 10, 15 people.
Mm.
How do you approach? It's always, I guess, an interesting topic when you go from you and your co-founder to maybe two people, to then the first five people, and then you need a bigger office space, you have 10 people, soon you're going to have 20 and 50. So how do you approach hiring? Is that your responsibility? Or is it more of a team effort? What do you look for in hiring a new person?
Yeah, it's me. And I think most important is passion,
mm-hmm,
and that there are a bit overflyers. So I expect them to work hard, I expect them to maybe work a bit more, and I expect them to think quick, like all the tasks. They need to give their inputs, they need to, you know, they really need to engage themselves.
Mm-hmm.
But we have like the top down perspective and the bottom up perspective, we will have the very much the bottom up perspective. So everybody has to improve, everybody has to, you know, every Monday we will have a Monday session where we discuss what are the next tasks and what are the goals and what are what people need to reach for by the end of the week. And so people need to be very motivated, they need to engage themselves, they need to be a bit an overflyer, they need to work because they have passion to work and they don't need to work for the money, kind of. So for sure you need the money, but you need to, just the passion is the first point.
Right.
And lots of people say that it's really cool to work at our place because they are the right match, because they are the people who do want to get engaged themselves and they can. And we do listen to them, and often if they have inputs, we also realize their ideas. So,
did you have any hires that didn't work out?
Yeah, I did have one. It was the idea of have a person in a certain position, which was very important for us, and the mentality was just completely different. So, in a startup, which is always changing, you have to adapt so much on the market.
Right.
And if you are used to clear structures, it might not work out, because you need to be able to handle that, it always changes. So maybe what was true yesterday is not anymore today,
mm-hmm,
and you need to adapt on the market just very quickly. And and also in startup, systems are always changing. You do working flows and everything, but maybe half a year later it's just different.
Right.
And so that's why it didn't work out.
Okay. And do you already have in mind a planned exit strategy? Do you foresee Coachfrog with an exit or an acquisition? Or do you plan to become a global Coachfrog and have your own empire and buy up all the other Coachfrogs?
Yeah, for sure we do have extra strategies, and we are in talk of that, but I think it's not the right moment to really think about an exit. For mm-hmm. sure, we do want to first really build it and expand it. And, yeah.
But do you think it's a train of thought or a concept you should have from the early stage? Because I think a lot of decisions that you make, you will have to account for at an exit. So is it something that you have in the back of the mind when you take on a new investment, when you plan new strategies or new expansions or new partnerships, or it's not really an active part of the strategy?
I think you always need an answer on where you're going to sell at any stage of where you are. Mm-hmm. Right? I think any investment that you're going to do, they will ask you, or, you know, they want to know where's the potential exit, where's the potential point that can get my money back. And for sure, we do know at any stage where could these possible exit partners be, but for sure, we don't see at the moment any point of exit.
Mm-hmm.
And we do want to build it, and we don't want to sell it.
Right. Okay. And what do you like the best about working at Coachfrog?
What I like the best?
Yes.
I think we have an unbelievably amazing market. I love the case that we kind of help people all the time to get into the right direction.
Mm-hmm.
And when it also, when it creates money, it's even better.
Right.
So I think the cool thing is just to make people happy and to have like a system which works out financially and maybe socially.
Mm-hmm. And have you had any moments where you felt like you've made it, or are you still on the road to looking for the next big win?
Yeah, I think like the moments when I think I've made it or maybe lost it for like 3 seconds and then it starts again. So whatever feels impossible right now, when you have reached it, you just like, yeah, 3 seconds later, it's just forgotten again. You're gonna
next mountain to climb.
Yeah.
And was there any moment, either with Coachfrog or previously, but that you've had a significant failure in the business, and how did you bounce back from that and overcome that moment?
Yeah, I mean, no, we didn't have a significant failure, but last investment round was pretty last minute, and I wouldn't do that again, because it means just sleeplessness, and
right.
You don't know if you have to quit all the people you hired, and yeah. So what I would do, and what I learned, and what I really recommend myself for the future, is to start early with investment rounds, and to look that liquidity is always managed well, and we have since then a very strong focus on our money and the cash flow.
A good point, yeah. It always takes longer than you expect, right?
Yeah, it was like last investment round, it was like we did pitches and then we saw it's going very well, and I thought it was so easy, we just get like all the investors, and then I saw that, you know, people who were maybe interested, it doesn't mean that they're gonna pay the money really. So
right.
Afterwards they were more like, you wanna subscribe? You wanna sign? Maybe no. And so what seemed well showed at the end that it didn't work out.
Mm-hmm.
So and like between this moment of I thought that we already have the whole investment round to the moment where I realized that we haven't for like 3 months, and then we really had to hurry up. But yeah, after all we had huge luck and we had double the money we needed, but it was just, you know, it was prolonged.
Yeah. And do you have any mentors?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah.
Actually, it was something it helped us a lot from the beginning. We did have lots of entrepreneurs which already built companies in the beginning, who helped us to create business plans, to help us with strategies. I could ask them, I mean, the most interesting was like how much money you spend in which area, how do you, I mean, what is worth the time, what is worth, you know, like all these questions, like very financial questions, I could ask them. Then we were into SAFE program, social entrepreneurship. We are actually in CTI project. We have many mentors, many supporters, many different features. We're helping us all over the world.
Right. And with the different support programs here in Switzerland, like you said, the SAFE and the CTI, how did you would you recommend that as well for other entrepreneurs, other founders to try to get into these programs? How was the support structure you received?
It was great. It was really, I mean, we had huge support from these startup supporting companies and foundations, and we didn't so much took part of awards, and I didn't, I mean, this is maybe the first speech in a entrepreneurship round I have. I never go to, like, very seldom I go to any events or something where you can meet people at all, but like these startup supporting programs, I am very happy and I'm very thankful that we have that and we still have that, because you need to prepare, they're gonna help you to prepare all your like business plans, they're gonna interview you, they're gonna give you feedback, they're gonna support you with mentors, they're gonna give you like experts who will help you in different stages. So I can honestly recommend that.
And you've received quite a bit of press and a bit of media attention, and I guess from the specific field you're in. Did you use a marketing agency or put out a lot of press releases, or was the marketing done from your side, or is it just that you guys are so cool that everyone wants to talk about you?
We did think about if you should take an agency, and we were in talk with one, and we saw that it's not the right choice and we're going to do it ourselves, but because I think, I mean, like very difficult decision it was, because we knew that at the end we need the connections, we need the contacts to the press and to the journalists, and but on the other side we thought we don't have them, so if you're going to send them an email they will not answer you.
Right.
And so how did you do that? I think one advantage we had is that we still are in the healthcare sector, and we thought we can send them health articles, we can start corporations, and you know. So since we did that with the newspaper and afterwards for Watson.ch, and then we did it for a health magazine, and now we do it for a magazine for older people, and all these press releases and all these publications helped us to get into other directions. And then I think it was that we, like, very important was that we did a survey about how many people in Switzerland do have chronic problems, and how many of them go into therapy. And at the end, it's 50% of all people who do have either chronic or psychological physical problems, and 50% of these people, they go into the therapy market. So, which means in total 25% of all people use therapy. We went with that to NZZ, it was worth the story, which made us very happy, and for sure it helped us to get into other newspapers. And then for sure we had good luck in all the healthcare magazines, because they saw there's something new, there's something like which people talk a long time about it. Like a lot of people who are in the sector know that there is a huge problem in the how you should find a therapist, since there is no travel agency, there's no like kind of channel doctor who helps you to get to find the right person in the therapy market. And so maybe they were lucky that we found the right people, the journalists who were interested to write about this project.
Okay. And what do you do in your downtime? What do you do to relax?
Skiing.
In the summer?
Biking. Okay. Whatever speed I like to have.
Go fast.
Go fast.
And when you got your first paying client, how was that? How did it happen? I guess you still had a smaller team.
Yeah, I think we were still in the cellar. And this was our first office, like a very small room in the cellar. And we, I think it was there where we started selling the first product. And I mean, it was nice. It was nice. I mean, it was not such a, like, I mean, maybe it was more like, okay, finally. You know, so.
But so much time and effort and finally get someone to.
Yeah, I think I find it now more fascinating where we started to create a sales team, and there's a sales manager, so he's reporting to me. I don't have to, you know, talk to all the people who try to sell something, but I have to talk to one person. And for me, this was a very impressive moment, just the moment where I could, you know, give the responsibility to get the right amount of money we had planned on the table. The right time
And going back a little bit to when it comes to team, what do you think is the most underappreciated skill set?
The most underappreciated skill set?
Skill set. So.
Okay, skill set.
Yeah. So typically you when you're hiring a sales manager, you're hiring a web developer, but often you don't see the underlying skills that people have, and then they join the team and you're like, oh wow, this guy's amazing at something unique, something different, or they bring such value to the team, not because of their actual day job, but because of something else. Is something stand out to you from that perspective?
Okay, so what is the most appreciated skill, which is not that visible in the beginning for me? I think it's just when people do long hours, and if they really, you know, like give ideas which maybe I haven't thought about them, and if they have, you know, if they're just overwhelmed, if they bring inputs, if they bring ideas which you haven't expected,
right?
If you, yeah, but most impressed I am if people are just, you know, like thinking out of the box, and you haven't told them.
Yeah. Any questions from you guys? Yes?
My question is, as a female founder, do you feel extra pressure or maybe extra drive to promote diversity or really like encourage the female workers in your team? Or is this, you just look at it as it's a team, or do you, is this, are you extra conscious of it somehow because you're a female founder, or?
In the beginning we were just men, and then there was a time where like only women. And now I try to like get a little bit the share, like a 50-50 share, because it's just, I think for the team structure it's better if you have both. And for sure there's like a little emotion in myself where I try to help female, you know, to like women to maybe like fulfill themselves and to get strong. But at the end, for the business, it's, for me it's important to have a stable team and to have both in the team. I think it's very important that we have like both parts. And male and female, they feel better if there's, you know, the other one.
What's your main focus at this point? Is it getting the next round, investors round going, or what are your main focus points?
We are officially launching our booking system on 1st of March. So the big challenge will be how we can bring the booking system very fast to a lot of people. And so the biggest focus at the moment is that. Next focus is, as I told before, is we do have a multiplicator. the multiplicator or the associations of the different therapies. And I do want to get the associations on one table. It's a very political market. And if you can convince the associations, you will get much more visibility and people will trust you much more because of the association. So next step will be that. And yes, we do have an investment round in front of us. It will be the summer. And for sure, I do also have to prepare for that.
How much are you going for?
Like between 1.5 and 2 million.
And on the topic of investors, are you? Is it mainly Swiss investors? Are there investors from abroad? How have you? Are you personally involved in finding investors, or do you have someone you're working with who's doing that for you, and you mainly do the pitching? What's been your experience so far with pitching to Swiss VCs or foreign VCs? How do you feel the investor scene is working here in Switzerland?
Okay. What I at that time I went to all the pitching opportunities I could. So I thought I need to get as many, you know, like investors to see me and to have the option one day to get one. And what I've seen but while pitching is that I do have I need to get people who are certainly involved with the project. Maybe they have thought already about a similar project. Maybe they are themselves in the same market and they see the problem in the market and they see that this is the solution they maybe have thought themselves before. We were looking for people who maybe have built marketplace in the past and maybe they have experiences with booking system, maybe they have experiences with building a team, maybe they have experience, maybe they have networks. And so it was because we did so many pitchings and we did so many, you know, meetings and mailings and it was actually mainly me and also one of my co-founders, we have a doctor also in our team. He and I were mainly focused on this topic. And what we found was actually one person who already built like an entrepreneur, mm-hmm. one person who was already in the healthcare system,
right.
and with the companies in the healthcare system, and one which was just very good connected with the investor scene, and one was just somebody who saw us at the pitch. So it was very diverse, but we saw that it's important for us that people are related with the product,
right.
and we saw that it's important also for them to have some relationship. And it's nice today for us that we get so much network out of the investors. Mm-hmm. And in the future, it will be more important to have international investors. It was not in the first investment round.
Okay. Do we have a question in the back?
Yes, you are focused on Swiss right now from the therapy side and also from the client side?
Yes.
And are you also focused on some special topics? So
yeah, we do have like six categories. Mm-hmm. We do have psychologists, we have coaching at the side, we have massages, we have complementary medicine, we have some like training, and we have nutritionists. But all in all, it's a secondary healthcare market, which is the third market.
Yes, yes.
Maybe follow up. So I'm curious, when you have a marketplace, how you build entry barriers to make it more difficult for others to enter the market. And it sounds like you're doing this thing with the booking system now and associations. Are you thinking of other ways to somehow connect with all your customers on the therapeutic side? For instance, building tools that they get more connected to your company versus potential competitors in the future?
Yeah, sure. I mean, we do want to bind our clients to our system. We do offer them websites, we do offer them our platform, we get them new clients, we give them a booking system where they can organize older clients, they have an administration tool for them personally, but they also connect with an online tool, they're connected with the platform. For sure, we do try to build a world around them. We do events every month for practitioners, where we invite speakers who have a different talk about the health topics, and then we strongly connect with the practitioners, so we build personal relationships with associations, with healthcare companies, with hospitals, with doctors' houses, and we very much try to position ourselves as the market. And I think the nice thing is actually what starts now is that third parties and they're gonna tell that we are just the one platform. So I just read in a healthcare magazine that where you find today the right therapist, and then we are the first stage, and then we have the insurances, and then we have the associations. So we do try to position ourselves everywhere for sure to keep our clients. And I think the strongest argument we do have, and where I have a huge focus, is strong customer service. So we do everything for practitioners, and we do everything for our clients.
So since you're working in the area of health, has that brought extra regulatory or legal challenges that you've encountered?
We are in the era of highly sensitive data, so you need to have certain protections, and we are improving on server topics, and you need to register yourself at the Swiss administration. And yeah, there are certain, just because of the sensitive data topic.
But you mentioned people are rating certain types of therapy,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Can it be construed as advice? And can you get into trouble for that?
No.
Okay.
No. If we as a company can get into trouble because of ratings?
Yeah, because you're saying, well, this therapy is supposedly the best for that type of problem.
So you can only rate practitioners.
Mm-hmm.
So you can, if you go to a physiotherapist, you could tell there that he could help you with your back pain and with physiotherapy, maybe osteopathy.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell your story that you had a bike accident 3 years ago, and that you went to a doctor, and then you had an operation, and afterwards you went to the physiotherapist. And we do prove all the feedbacks we publish, and then the practitioner gets an email that he has any feedback, and then he can hide it if he wants. But so far I don't know that this should give any problem. No.
I have one other question about the healthcare markets in Swiss in general. Is all your consulting or all your offers you give in the second healthcare market, is it private pay, or is there some insurance company who pays 80% or 50%? Or it is everything paid by the clients?
We are mainly in a market which is paid by additional health insurances.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's physiotherapy is paid if you go to the doctor, and he will give you, order you to go to a physiotherapist. Psychotherapist, same. And nutritionist, same. But all the others, you have some of the alternative medicine, which is part of the basic insurance, but mostly are part of the additional insurance. And we are mostly in this market, in the market paid by the additional insurances. But we have very strict quality improvements, but it's it's not exactly if there are additional health insurance, you cannot claim it just, you know, by this, but at the end 90% will be additional health insurance.
Okay. Now that makes sense.
So we have time for maybe one more question from the audience. Yes.
So my question is, you are 2 years old now officially.
Mm.
What are the three key differences in how do you have imagined yourself 2 years ago at this point of time now? Yourself and in your company. And what is the reality now? So what are the differences between this vision as of 2 years ago and the reality now?
Okay, 2 years ago I thought we do already have a base in Germany and we have already expanded abroad. It's a key difference. So I see that it takes much more to get a product into the market, which is new. I see much more recognition as I thought. I see that, you know, lots of like political activated people come towards us, and also people out of economy, like, you know. So I'm interested, or I'm, you know, I appreciate how big the resonance is out of the market. So it's bigger than I thought. And actually a third I don't have. I have one which is like I under-expected, and one which I over-expected. And what is good is it's still our passion, it's still the, like, the market we want to treat. And we still see that there is a problem and we want to do the solution that people find immediately to their practitioner or the therapist who can help them.
Last question.
Yeah, I just wondering what skills you mastered to get this far in your entrepreneurial career. Like, what skills were game changers? What skills were incredibly important and vital to reach the level of success that your company has reached as an entrepreneur? Mm.
So what I have to learn is that there are so many opinions. In the very beginning stage, I opened up. I mean, from my nature, I'm a person who's going straight. I see my goal and I just walk there and I'm gonna reach it. And I will not listen. So like people sometimes say that, you know, I could break walls. But it's not always good because sometimes you can walk against the wall and you know, you're gonna hit. And so I started listening and opened up, and for me it was a huge challenge to honestly listen to different opinions. And I did, and in the very beginning it very confused me, because there were people I respected a lot and they 100% you know, explained to me that if you don't go this direction, you will fail. And another person who was also very successful did the opposite. If you don't go in this direction, you're going to fail. And there was another, if you don't go in this direction, for sure you're going to fail. You need to, you know. And then, like, after, like, you know, I need to recover from this. But today, I managed to get all the opinions and to keep my own way, and I think it made me stronger to open up and to take all the inputs, all the ideas, to take all the help I can get, but still follow, you know, the direction I think again is the right one.
Really?
Thanks.
I have actually two. But when was the point in time when you figured which are your key three strengths? And the other one is, what are the two advices? What are the two things you would do differently today if you would have known it already 2 years ago?
So the moment I realized the one with the strength was actually when I took my own decision, and I saw that it was right. So at this point I saw, like, you go to the question before, right? At this point I saw that it's right just to listen to everything and to open your mind, to see all the opinions, all the perspectives, all the ways to go, and also to understand why it could be the way to go. Today I think there are many ways to go, but you should find it somehow the way you need to go. And I think when I saw the way I went, it was fine, I realized it was good. And the second question is, like, what did I, in the past, what I recognized today that I thought it was different in the past?
No. Like, if you would, today you have so much learnings already, mm-hmm. right? What are, like, the two things that you think, okay, this is, if I would have known this already 2 years ago, I would have done it completely different, and I would have been at a different point today. So, like, if you would have wanted to have expanded to Germany and everything already today, what do you think you would have had to do differently? Like, what learnings would you have to have back?
I think it's pretty impossible to have already expanded
to. So the learning would be that it takes more time than you expected.
Yeah.
Patience.
Yeah, it takes more time.
Would you have needed more money in the beginning as well?
Mm-hmm.
Or more people around you? Anything?
No, I think, you know, if you have already built a company and you already know exactly how it works. But even then, I know so many people who already built something and then they try to do something new and then it doesn't work out. So I think each project is different. And you need to, like, find the right way for your very specific project. And I know many projects, they stay in one place, or in one country, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, and you really need to figure out all that they want to spend and they will spend in the future. I could not say that we should have raised more money. I could not say that, you know. What I see now is that we do need, you know, better brains, more brains, like that we need to have more horses who, you know, get, you know, the company where we need to go. But I cannot tell you, like, you know, the learnings, the kind of mistakes I see, you know, what we did. I see everything is a learning, and we could not have known better. We did our best all the time. I don't see, you know, for the future, maybe you see, like, ways we didn't work out, but if you, maybe there are different, like, things you have to pick, right? We couldn't follow, but how should we have known if we have not tried that? So should we now, like, punish that we have tried that? We must have tried that because nobody could say if it works out or if not. So, yeah, I would say we do have to learn a lot, and I see many things we are always changing, but I very much see in the future.
So the experience is part of the journey. It's part of the process. You have to grow it. So we'd like to. It's already been. I'd probably be here a lot longer, but we have to wrap up now. And we'd like to wrap up with a few very short, very specific questions. Pretty simple. And the idea is you answer with the first thing that comes to mind. So just real quick, ask a question, give an answer. So what's one item that you own that you would never sell?
I don't have any.
What is your most unusual skill?
I think my passion to people.
What is more important, strength, speed, or stamina? And which historical figure do you most admire?
Um,
Could be, it doesn't have to be history per se, but...
Yeah, I think, like, I think about Jesus, the Pope.
When was, what is your favorite season of the year?
Autumn.
And when was the last time you tried something new?
Today I bought this shirt.
And if you could have the attribute of any animal, which animal would you choose?
The fur. The fur.
The fur.
The frog.
The frog.
Oh, the frog. The frog. So thank you so much, Kathrin, for joining us tonight and for the insights and lessons you shared. It's really valuable. Really appreciate it. And so happy that you could join us tonight.
Thank you.